office started, was registered on 28th of February 1978. And since then we have actually been practicing. We were very young indeed. Me and another colleague of mine, extremely young, our families were young. But we managed to pick up courage. Basically myself, after 1.5 years working in the Ministry of Works, I managed to pick up courage and start the office on 28th of February 1978. So we have been moving on since that time. Out of sheer courage, we decided that we have to start an office, myself and a colleague of mine. Mm-hmm. And of course, nobody believes it. Nobody thought that a young people like myself can be able to start a company at that time. But I think it's out of sheer courage that we just simply went out to try ourselves. And by God's grace, it appeared it worked out. The challenges are very many, and depending on the stage of our work and our office. First of all, when you are a young person, of course, many clients do not trust you because one thing with your face, the way you look, betrays you, and they think really you have got minimal experience, and therefore, they don't trust they can give you large work. But I think we simply, some of the people we knew, the churches, for example, the Methodist Church in Kenya, the Presbyterian Church of East Africa, ACK, and others, I think they trusted us. So they started giving us some jobs, churches, of course, and shops, designing of shop fronts. And I mean, a bit of our work was out of Nairobi, in Meru and other places, because those are the areas people could seriously think that we can do work. But Nairobi was very difficult at the beginning because of really the lack of experience in terms of we were very young. We were among the first company to computerize in 1990. At that time, there were very limited computers in Kenya. In fact, the only computer which was well known was one in the Department of Engineering, University of Nairobi, which we used to be told is as big as an engine of a car. I had not seen it myself, but there was a lot of stories about that machine. Then 1990, we decided to computerize to get the program on ARCHICAD. We got somebody from South Africa to come and train us. And then from there, we really picked up from that time. So in issues of design, now we are heavily computerized. We have got all what we need, both in terms of computers, in terms of programs. I think that really, that bit of technology, in terms of design, it has been able to help us a lot. It's very competitive these days, bearing in mind, of course, there are about 3 universities producing architects in Kenya. So the field has become very, very, very competitive at the moment because there are proposals, you make proposals together with others, there are proposals to be decided together with others. So we are aware there is that competition. But I think because of our experience, which we have been able to generate over the years, this now has given us a competitive edge, not only the experience, the technology, because we really do a lot of traveling, attending international conferences and seminars. This has helped us really seriously to be in a position that we can turn out good and iconic buildings. And I think that bit has helped us a lot. Well, the kind of staff that we have, first of all, of course, some of them have joined us as graduates, others have joined us where they have already practiced outside for quite a while. But those who have joined us as graduates, we train them internally, we train them here in the office. And I personally help them, they come to my office, I help them to to think about the design, to look, I help them. Once they have designed something, I look at the work that they are doing. I take them out to the field where we have got work going on for them to get the field experience. So we do have staff who are really properly trained now. I think I must make you aware that we have two offices, one in Nairobi, the other one in the slum. Both offices are really have done considerable work, and we have got staff in the slum, we have got staff in Nairobi, and we can as well see it now. I think we have got the people we need, we can do the work, any work that we get from clients. First of all, let me say that we are regional architects. Okay. Yeah, I used to have an office in Botswana, but we are too young, we cruised it. Okay. But now we do have a Nairobi office and a Dar es Salaam office. Now, when we did the Tanzanian Parliament, 2004 to 2006, and we were able to complete the work, that work, and we are able to hand it over to Mheshimiwa Jakaya Kikwete, the President of the United Republic of Tanzania. Yeah. I think the Tanzanians at that point in time realized that we can do work. So at the moment we are doing the largest, the highest building in the slum, that is Tanzania Ports Authority. Just about that meters from the sea is at the 5 floors. Yeah. It has got parking, commercial areas, conferences, offices. We are engaged on another large project in the slum, that is a ultra-modern shopping mall in Mwanza. This is a 50,000 square meters of shopping facilities. It has got 4 levels, several escalators, several panoramic lifts. I think it's among the biggest shopping mall now in our region, in Eastern Africa. So we are engaged on that one as well. Of course, we have done the Kenya Parliament, as you are aware, the modernization of our National Assembly. That was, we did it, very tough project, because it's an old project. We went through it. So those are some of the projects that we have actually been able to do. We are in East Africa. I think first of all, there is enough work in East Africa. If we are an architect is keen enough on what is going around, including this street alone, there's a lot of projects that are taking place. The K&M Archplans cannot finish all what we have in East Africa. So the need to go out at the moment, not that pressing. There is a need to go out when 1999, when we went to Dar es Salaam, because there was very little work in Kenya. Yeah. Now, if you see now cranes all over Westlands, Upper Hill, Kilimani, so there is work. It's not only for us as an office, there is a work for everybody. Yeah. So there isn't really what person I would call a pressing need to go out. But we may be able to go out to other places. I hear about Sudan, I have not gone there. I hear about Ethiopia. I've not gone there myself. I have stayed and been in Botswana. So I want to, first of all, we concentrate on what we have at home. We do town planning, but it's not on a very large scale. We have really been involved in doing a lot of master plan, particularly for universities. For KEMU, we have done master plan. For Meru University of Technology, Science and Technology, we have done master plan. We are now finalizing the master plan of Laikipia campus. So we have been involved in a number of master plan. We did actually Chuka University. We also did a planning of that campus. So we definitely are involved in that kind of work. The trend industry, please, is this, that Kenyan architects travel a lot. And therefore they borrow a lot of ideas from outside. And some of the ideas that you find on buildings which are coming in Kenya, actually there are some of those experiences architects in Kenya have been able to pick them from there. Of course, it is not good to import a design it is not good at all to be imported inside from outside, because the climates outside there are different, the environment is different, the culture of the people is different. So it is you can go out to see what others are doing, but it's not important, it is not good for you to kind of wholeheartedly bring a project here from outside. Mm. But I think there is a lot of work because of this kind of traveling and the world now having become a village and the technology also, yeah, that you find there is a lot of activity of work in Nairobi. And I must say, good work. I must say, architects are coming with good work in Nairobi. Mm. But I must caution that that work should not, building should not be important. We should also be able to create our own buildings. Buildings which are able to meet the needs of our own people, both in terms of green architecture, in terms of sustainable designs. Yeah. These are areas which are important now, so that you don't build the buildings which are become consumers of energy. Yeah. You don't take care of water. Yeah. You within the building, you waste too much water. Within the building, you don't allow building to, you don't shade your building. In fact, some of the buildings are very bad without, where the people who are working inside, yeah, they have a lot of glare and a lot of sun, and the building can become very hot. Mm. These are areas inside when you are working, these are areas that architects have seriously to take care of. Yeah. And then from there, I think we are going to get very good architects. So the technology is there. Of course, ours is a bit different. Yeah. Apart from the technology, we do iconic buildings. If you look at it, the Tanzanian Parliament is a creation out of traditional art. Yeah. The Tanzania Ports Authority building, it is a moving boat, because it belongs to the port. If you look at the design, it's a moving boat, and so on, and you can see it. You can actually, you'll be able to see it down there. It's a boat, which is moving, it's a ship, yeah, which is actually moving. Yeah. And the project is basically now, is basically complete. The structure is complete, they are just doing inside. Yeah. They are doing inside. So you see that is borrowed very heavily. The concept is borrowed very heavily from a moving boat. So yeah, there are those kind of things that you can do. But I think the kind of architect which is coming in East Africa is actually good. I think the secret is experience, to be honest with you.
Okay.
Yeah. You can't just, you have come out of maybe a college.
Yeah.
Then you think within 1 year, mm, that you do a building like that. Yeah. It's not possible. The reason is, even before we put that building, yeah, there are a lot of issues that we are to deal with. One of the issues, since it's by the sea,
yeah,
we had to go out of the country to Miami, yeah, to be able to make sure that the building is tested against the wind. Okay, they blow a lot of wind towards the building,
yeah,
to find out the building does not, at the seaside, start to sway.
Yeah.
So that building has now got 700 columns,
okay,
all of them going 10 meters down, setting on the rock, setting on the rock below,
yeah,
and that is important, because you can't hang it on the top and you think the building will be able to survive. So that's one of the technology you have to go out, yeah, or find out what exactly you are doing. The Tanzanian Parliament, we had a problem of earthquake,
yeah,
because it's on the Rift Valley zone.
Oh, yeah.
So there were issues of the earthquake, and you know, a parliament, all the big people from Tanzania will be there.
Yeah.
So we had to caution against the building, even if there is a earthquake,
yeah,
against the building shaking and getting into a lot of issues.
Yeah.
The market I bring also has got some issues. Because of the moans, the rock, there's a lot of water underground. Actually, underground is rivers, all right?
Okay.
Now, when you have got underground rivers also, you have to be very careful. Otherwise, the parkings and the basement and so on, how do you protect the building from having a lot of water when you have got the underground, when you have got the underground water,
yeah,
rivers, underground rivers going on. So the to an architect, There is no other trick than really being patient and having the necessary experience in order that to develop projects of this nature. Because large projects have got their own challenges, and they have to be taken care of, so that at least at the end of the day, the people who are using that building are properly protected between calamities and issues. You are already aware some of the Kenyan buildings are coming down. Either there are issues with the structures, there are issues with materials which have not been properly used, or mixtures which have not been properly used. So we have an issue in Kenya at the moment of building coming down and losing a lot of people because the buildings were not properly taken up by experienced consultants and experienced contractors and clients who are willing to pay for their building to stand. So if you go and start thinking of cutting corners, then definitely we are waiting for a disaster on anywhere. Where you cut corners on a structure which is going several levels, on a house built on man, there are no issues. But if you are to think 2, 3, 4 levels, then that building must professionally be looked after, so that at the end of the day, the building, apart from, of course, the use of the building inside, that building must be able to stand. Otherwise, it will go down together with the people. Because if you have a building where you don't have a qualified structural engineer who looks after that building, definitely it will come down. So you not only the design, you need the supervision of the project. It will be able to come down. So for you to be safe on this, get the right consultant to be able to undertake your work. And you may spend a bit more, but at the end of the day, you have got a long-lasting building. You know that one, these days you have a lot of problems with authorities. May it be the local approving authorities, may it be NEMA, may it be National Construction Authority. If you are not careful, in fact, even if you don't bring, even your building doesn't come down, those two or three authorities can also bring your building down. They have got the legal requirement. They have the tools to bring your building down. And even if they don't bring the building down themselves, and they say that building cannot be used by people, definitely you have a building there, but it will remain empty. It will remain empty for many years. So that business which you wanted to have in the building will be no longer be there because there are exits and the word remove. Once you see exits and exits, then you must know, my brother, you are seriously in trouble. The KICC is one building that really represents, because of the culture, particularly the amphitheater. The amphitheater really represents our own traditional art. They do give a lot of respect for the architect, the Norwegian architect who came up with that kind of concept. So that, I think, to me, if you ask me, one building, that building represents us. Of course, don't forget there are other monuments, whether they were done by our own architects or people from outside, they are monuments. Of course, Kenyatta, in terms of culturally representing us, but don't forget our own National Assembly. National Assembly is a monument. You can't, whatever it looks, that it represents a lot of the country, whether you are taking the tower or the sweeping curves. That is another building which actually represents us. Of course, there are a lot more buildings, older ones, if you are saying. But the buildings which have come up in Upper Hill are also interesting. Some of the buildings there are very interesting. They represent a certain direction and they are a certain age of architecture. the one which are coming up here. Mm-hmm. Some of them are really, I must say, they are very, very interesting. When you look at K&M Archplans is not Kimathi. Yeah. It is a company which is able to transcend generations. That's my interest. Yeah, it doesn't start with Kimathi and end up with Kimathi. It has to move generations. And that is the way K&M Archplans now is set.
Yeah.
Because I would like to see if I'm there, 2050, there is K&M. Yeah, 3000, there is K&M. You see? So that the children of this country can have a place to practice, can have a place to practice architecture. So it is not a model that it just starts and ends up with one or two individuals. It should be able to be transgenerational. It can be move ahead. And it's not only to the members of staff who are here, even to the universities. Yeah. When you came, you saw a student down here. I normally see every student who comes to see me.
Yeah.
Because I want even to them to see inside of my office. I don't stop talk them down there at the secretary.
Yeah.
I want even to them to see my office, so that at least they have an image,
yeah,
of what an architectural firm is.
Yeah.
So to me, that is very important. Or this major project like Tanzanian Parliament, it was an international competition. So we won that one.
Mm-hmm.
You take a Kenya Parliament, which you are aware, it was a competition between various firms. We won that one. It was organized by Kenya Parliament itself and the Minister of Works.
Okay.
Yeah. I was not the only one who submitted, many firms submitted their work,
yeah,
and they evaluated the work, they look at who is the best. That's how they come out. So that's another one that we actually won. I think I must say also, maybe you are aware that I'm a fellow of the Architectural Association of Kenya.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that is very important in terms of the association. I must say I've traveled, mm-hmm, very extremely widely.
Yeah.
I think the only country I have not ventured to go,
yeah,
hopefully, who is Southern America.
Yeah.
But all Europe, Americas, Asia,
yeah,
I've traveled a lot in Asia. Particularly when I was doing the Tanzanian Parliament,
yeah,
and the Kenyan Parliament.
Mm.
I traveled Australia, Spain,
yeah,
London, many countries, with South Africa, many countries with India. I not only doing architecture here, I've also recorded my work.
Yeah.
I've written this book, Parliament
and the Architecture.
Yeah, Parliament and the Architecture. This is a book which was published by an Australian company.
Okay.
And it's being distributed now all over the world by Amazon. So it's a record of my experiences with the Parliament,
okay,
what they do, Kenya, Tanzania. We competed also in the East African Parliament,
mm-hmm,
although we never managed to go about it. We competed in Pan-African Parliament.
Mm-hmm.
So it's those kind of experiences that I've been able to put together in this book.
Yeah.
I'm having also writing another book on the various sketches,
yeah,
as an architect I've made over the years,
yeah,
since I was college. I've kept my all my work in terms of sketches.
Yeah.
This is the next book that I want to come up with.
Yeah.
So I think apart from design, which I participate very effectively on what we do here, I also record my work in the way of writing. So there is a lot of literature in my office here, which you can, as a young architect, which you can get.
Yeah.
Both in terms of drawing, in terms of a bit of books.
Yeah.
I must say also I have a very large library. Of course, I don't keep it here.
Yeah.
My library at home, very large library, because I've collected books from all over the world.
Yeah.
So I've kept those ones as to enable me to consult, to have a room. So I do have that kind of library. So that's how I manage to keep myself,
yeah,
up to date with the work in architecture. I started with public health.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. I started with public health.
Okay.
I went to the currently known as Kenya Medical Training College.
Okay.
So I did a diploma in public health offered by the Royal Society of Health at that time.
Okay.
So I did 3 years and I qualified.
Okay.
So I was here going the field to do public health. But when I was about to go to the field, I applied to go to the University of Nairobi. So I was accepted there.
Okay.
By that time, they were offering they were offering 2 degrees, the one a bachelor, the other one a master's degree at that time. So I managed to do it, to finish it. Then after finishing the university, of course, I went out. I've done a few other things, like I'm an expert on environmental assessment.
Okay.
I studied that environmental assessment, so I'm an expert on that area. Of course, I've participated in various, I'm also at the moment an examiner on orals for the architects who are coming out. So, I've been requested by Borax to be an examiner for the architects who want to register and come out. So an examiner in that particular area. So those are some of the things I've been able to do and some of my interests. Upcoming architect, I think architecture is a profession which takes like medicine. It takes a long time to mature. This is a profession which takes a long, long, long time to mature. So you just can't go in the university 6 years, you come out immediately, you think you just turn out to be an architect. It's not like cooking chips. It's like cooking kederi, if you understand what I really am saying. It takes time. With the patience, you can always, with patience, you can always be there. May I say also, you need to come out with some very good principles on how do you want to work, why do you want to work, how do you want to approach your clients, the people who are giving you work, what is your relationship between yourself and the clients and the contractor. And to me, you should be extremely careful on some areas which may appear attractive, but they can be dangerous in architecture. So it is very important that you are very careful and you have got the principles on what you want to do. You can say yes, you can say no. If you are the kind of person who cannot say no, then you can be a bit sad because you can push into some areas. But I must say is architecture is art and science.
Okay.
It's very interesting. It's very absorbing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Very, very absorbing.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you are not careful, it will just pick you and absorb you because this is an art. And science.
Yeah.
It's not like doing other things which you just do them and forget about it. This is something you have to constantly try to practice, try to understand. There are issues. Architecture is very challenging, honestly. To put a building like that one, it has so many areas and issues, both in art and in science, that you have to do with. You have to deal with a lot of people, some of them very senior. Like if you are building a parliament, you have to deal with the Parliamentary Service Commission, which are very, very senior organ of the parliament, and therefore you have to know exactly how to deal with them and to handle them. If you are doing parliament, you have to meet speakers. Even county assemblies, you have to meet very senior people within the county assembly. Okay, both the speaker or the governor. So you have to have the skill and the understanding, and you must be business-like in trying to approach those areas. I must finally say, you have to have a lot of technology.
Yeah.
Whether you are using your mobile, whether you are using your iPad, whether you are using my computer, which is inside somewhere there, whether you are using the computer, you must be conversant with the present technology. There are other technologies which are very important relating to the buildings. For example, if you are doing with a chamber or a county assembly, there are issues of lighting, there are issues of mechanical ventilation that you are dealing with, there are issues of acoustics. Otherwise, if the members cannot hear one another, you may as well bring a bulldozer. That assembly is not useful. Yeah. So you must find a technology which, when they are inside here, they can be able to hear one another. Of course, there are a lot of now equipment. There is a lot of equipment within that area. Whether you are talking about DCN or microphone management or management of data, which they are generating within that area, which has to go somewhere to the answer that is processed, speaking into words. Okay, there are all those management. So the technology within the building now is also extremely challenging. Even a house is no longer the same house, the domestic house we need. The kitchen, the demands from the owner of the kitchen or from the owner of the house are heavy. Yeah, because you are not just cooking with the old decors. Yes. These days, there are a lot of other things which have come in.
Yeah.
How you design a living room is also very important. So there are many things that you consider. You have to consider the artwork, yeah, of the building. You have to consider the climate within the building. You have to consider the beauty of the building. When it looks like it, see something, turn and say, wow. Who has designed that building? What kind of building is that? Okay?
No.
So you have to realize to see what brings that kind of art. When people see it, it's not an eyesore. Okay? When people enter it, they feel this is a very interesting structure at the building.
Yeah.
So there are a lot of people have to see, so there are a lot of other technologies which has come in on building, which the architect together with the other colleagues, with other consultants, have to bring all those technologies together so that even the building itself, you see, the building can have life and can perform.
Yeah.
Just like the way you find a human being performing, there are buildings which perform.
Yeah.
There are other buildings which don't perform at all. It's always a struggle with those who use them because they were poorly conceived and poorly designed.